Okay, so this is the second half of last week's lecture, because obviously we had thought works in. So a couple of things. First of all, I think there's been some talk about what's going to happen in the last week of the term. Which is the 8th, Wednesday the 8th, I think it is, of May. And so generally there's still going to be lectures for this. So for this course, on that date, there's two lectures on. The first lecture is for the BBC, so the BBC Research and Development will be coming in to give you a lecture on how they do user experience at the BBC. And secondly, there'll be a revision lecture. Okay. So, for the revision lecture part, if you have got any questions about the course, what you need to revise, what you don't understand, what things you want to understand more, you need to send me an email with those on it. Okay? If you don't send me an email, then there'll be nothing to talk about. It'll be a very quick lecture. Because I'll presume that you're all good. Yeah? So, I'll only create this lecture, the lecture for the last week, I'll only create that when you've sent me email saying what you want to cover. Yeah? So if you don't send me email, it won't get covered. Okay? Okay, yeah.
You have not had the entire two sessions, revisions?
No.
Instead of having BBC.
No. The BBC is super important, especially for exams, and the BBC is super important because it gives you a real understanding of what you've experienced about, and that's the most important thing after this course. Okay. Next week, I'm over here. I'll be in Paris at a research conference. And so Andy Brown will be delivering next week's lecture. Okay, next week's two lectures. As I say, it's on the way, so it'll just be the same as me. Okay, so voice loops for the spaceship. Okay, so some people, I think, were saying on Facebook, at least my spies on Facebook have been telling me, that there's some problem with voice loops. I presume we've all submitted, right? Otherwise, it's a serious problem, yes. So, some were saying that they couldn't do it in 250 words, or it was difficult to do in 250 words. So, first of all, did what did people think of voice loops as a paper?
Interesting. Yeah. Very what? Repetitive.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Same
half
things,
one
of the guys
in more words, but
with
more detail.
Yeah. Okay.
The link between
UX1
obvious.
Good. It's not meant to be. That's what you're there for. You'll get these kind of papers when you're working for the BBC or for some companies. Yeah. So. You have to make, you know, the whole point is for this final one is that it's not absolutely obvious, but it is there is a link there, so, you know, but maybe only you guys as UX people would understand what that link is, and that's the whole point of doing this kind of stuff. Yeah? Okay, so who found it difficult to write in 250 words? One, two. Oh, that's good. Two, that's okay, not bad. So it is difficult to write in, to write in 250 words to be sort of direct about it, but you know, that's what normally the industrial standard, well, that's not normally, that is the industrial standard, 250 words is what you can get in the real world. So, need to leave now. Okay. Does anybody have any questions about last week's ThoughtWorks presentation? So, was everything that they were saying and that was there for them, that they were discussing with you regarding design, was that kind of, could you match that to our conversations about designing user experience and the chapter on designing for say using things like scenarios and requirements and citations to scenarios, personas, those kind of things. Could you see links between them? Storyboarding? Stories, wireframes?
I don't think that was emphasised in her talk at all.
No, it's not, it wasn't meant to be. I mean, she was giving only the talk about how they do it. But what you need to realise is that the tools you've been given, the things we've spoken about, are the foundational points which you can slot into. The idea is that you'll be able to slot them into any kind of work frame, framework, should I say, that that you might have in a work environment. So, for instance, she's there doing her, Diana's doing her part with regard to the storyboarding with post-it notes. Okay, well, you can easily rationalise the storyboarding that you actually have been taught and sort of understand and slot that. You should be able to slot that into a new, into the work, into the knowledge that you have, but also into a different company, whether you might go to a different company that uses a slightly different technique, but you still be able to use the storyboarding idea because it's kind of understandable. That's the idea of it. The heavy reliance on post-it notes, yeah, that's also something that you get in a lot of corporations like this now for design. The iterative, fast iterative cycles that they're going, the people where you've got focus groups of people. So all of that should be something that you understand already. And you can slot in the foundational stuff that you've been presented here with what Darren was saying. And of course, you'll see next week, not next week, week after next, that the BBC do this differently. But they still use the basic techniques, they just put them together differently. Okay. So, could you see that, or couldn't you see that? Can you see it now? Yeah?
I really like the, how they go, like, in person to the shop, or whatever, you know, setting they are actually developing that for, and taking the pictures of the, like, customer interaction,
yeah.
So really, like, getting into the shoes of, say, the customer to understand what's going on.
Yeah, it's a really good way that they've got to do things, but of course, what do you think about the way that they the way that they do things, what, with regard to how it's done in real life? I mean, if I was going to get Thoughtworks to come in and do something for me, what would I need to be? What would I need to have?
Money.
Money. Yeah. Because it's quite expensive. The way they do it is very, very consuming of consultant fees, isn't it? You know, there's lots of them all doing this stuff, all putting forward. You know, pair programming. It's very highly. You know, if you're actually programming there with somebody from the organisation with you, it takes a lot more time, there's a lot more effort that you're, you know, that you're actually, not more time, but you're on site, and that costs money to, you know, that costs money. So you might not have that in such big corporations. In smaller corporations, you might not have that. Yeah?
I was wondering, other people working there,
or
in that company, in those teams, do they have that formal education in
UX
or HCI, or is that not needed?
Well, it's not formal education, so, yeah, in UX and HCI, there's very few formal, there's very few courses, okay, units. So a lot of the courses that are in HCI, and there's nothing very much in UX. All the courses in HCI are all about are mostly postgraduate courses, so they're master's level courses, and mostly they come from. There's a few more different ones in America. So in America, it's slightly different because they're more into the HCI stuff there. So generally, you know, they have one or two undergraduate courses, but not lots. Mostly it's postgraduate courses, and mostly they're coming from a psychology background. So mostly this is sort of technical training. Often it can be thought of as technical training for psychologists in some ways. However, the way we're doing it is UX training for software engineers. That's the kind of idea, because what it turns out is that all the companies we've spoken with, there's so much need for technically good people doing user experience, people who can code, people who can think in this abstract computational way. There's lots of need for that. Okay, so if you're a computer scientist and then have HCI training, you've got far greater chance of getting a UX HCI job than you are if you're a psychologist with some HCI training, just because they want the technical competences that you possess. Okay, but layered with an understanding of user stuff. Yeah. Okay, so where were we up to last week?
Dependent variables, measuring dependent variables,
and all that kind of stuff. Stuff that is going more into the psychology aspects, the way that we get a good design for an experiment. Okay. So what we're going to do this time is we're going to finish off doing that for the first 5 to 9. For the first 45, 50 minutes now, and then after that we're going to switch on to another one which would be important for your exam, so I suggest you don't leave, called In Real Life, so how this kind of goes, how this happens in real life, like the sort of things that they might have to overcome, or the rationale for why people are doing this in real life. Okay, so I can't get this slide, this screen to work, some of them isn't just going to do it, so it's really broken. Okay, so this is the general way that we actually do things, or that you need to do things. Now you can see that in last week's ThoughtWorks lecture, they do this in very small slices and very iteratively. So it's all, so how many of you do Agile then? I know I've asked this before, but 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Okay, how many know what Agile is? Okay, good, so most people. Okay, so Agile is something that is now the link between Agile and user experience and UX is really strong. And so while this kind of thing might actually always happens, it happens, may happen at different speeds, if you like, different iterations, iterative speeds. Okay? So you wouldn't normally do this once, now you normally do it multiple times as you're going through an experimentation. Okay? So they call it, if that's the case, they call it incremental evaluation. So the first thing is, you have an experimental design. So this experimental design, well, what kind of things might you have to think about in the experimental design? You all seem very quiet today, so I'm going to have to start picking on people, throwing things.
Sorry, is that the design of an experiment, or is that an experimental design of something?
The design of an experiment.
Right.
Yeah. Okay. So if we were designing an experiment, which we could say is an evaluation, what kind of thing would we be thinking of that we're going to have in there? Yeah?
Basic inputs and outputs of how you're going to ask the test. This is how you're going to perform this experiment.
Okay, so basic inputs and outputs, how you're going to perform this experiment, so methodology.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah? So we've got a methodology that we're going to follow. Okay?
One hypothesis.
Yes? And why would we have a hypothesis? What's the point of a hypothesis?
Kind of prove something,
whether you thought it was wrong or right. Okay, so say that again. You want to prove something, whether it was wrong or right.
Well, you can expect something out of the experience.
Okay, but can you prove something that's wrong? Is that a proof?
Well, you kind of dissing your hypothesis by finding a wrong case.
Yes, so you can prove your hypothesis, because one instance that disproves your hypothesis.
Yeah.
But can you prove your hypothesis?
You can support it. Really.
Yes, you can support it. Why can you support it, anybody? Why can't you prove your hypothesis in experimental work?
You can't possibly test like every, or you can't exhaustively test in real work. Probably.
Yeah, you can't exhaustively test, make every test that you possibly could. It's not possible in experimental work. So the point of that is that if you can actually have, if you only get one instance of the disproval, that's good enough to disprove your hypothesis. So your hypothesis tells you whether how your work is progressing, okay? Whether you can believe the results you're getting, okay? Because sometimes your hypothesis will be disproved, sometimes it will be supported. If it's supported, what kind of hypothesis should it be? Give me what kind of hypothesis should it be?
Well, weak ones are easy to disprove.
Give me an example of a weak one.
All something is something.
Okay.
As soon as one instance counters that, then it breaks.
So would you say that's weak or strong?
I would say weak, but I don't know.
It's strong because it's brittle, because it can be, because you know that it's testable, right? It's got to be testable. So if you can say all instances, well, you only have to find one, whereas if you want to say, well, these 10.
I guess it sounds counterintuitive to say if something is strong, it's therefore easy to break.
Yeah, but because if it's not broken, it strongly supports what you're doing. Your hypothesis. Okay, good. Anything else we want in the experimental design? What about the participants? Yeah.
You need to select them totally randomly.
Totally randomly. Okay, so we could select them totally randomly, but if you got this, if we were saying this is the population, if we said this is the population in here, if we randomly selected five people, do you think that would be a good representation of the population? Because the sample you're trying to draw, the participants you're trying to draw, are supposed to be what's called a representative sample of the population. So do you think if we randomly selected five people, that would be good in here?
You probably need to select more.
You need to select more. So if we could only select five, what might we do, knowing that this is a population? We might pick them because we want to make up a certain demographic, so it wouldn't be random then, because we're trying to have a smaller sample of the bigger population. But you're right, random sampling is really good if you've got enough people in your sample and the population is huge and you don't know what that population is made up of. It's really strong then to have a really good random sample, but you need enough participants and you need a really big population that you're trying to shrink down, because you've got a lot of participants. Remember, the whole point of doing this is that it's going to be very difficult to do everybody, but it might not be so difficult to do just a small sample. So that's why we draw a sample. If I do some analysis on the population, the outcome of that analysis, if I do it on a sample, it's called a statistic. Okay, but what is it if I do it on the population? It's called a parameter. So I can test the entire population and say this is exactly what this population says, thinks, does. But sometimes that's not possible. But if I can do it on, say I can do it, I say your view of the population, I do it on all of you, then I'm getting back a parameter. Okay. So, we've got our participants. How might we design this methodology then? What do we want to do to design this methodology? So say you've built a computer system, and you've been asked to go into an organisation. For instance, last week at ThoughtWorks, they were asked to go into an organisation, they've got a new application that they're putting on phones, which is the one that does offers in a shopping list. So, how do we know whether that's a good thing? How do they know whether that's working to get more people into their stores, to understand the offer, for people to actually go into the stores just to get those offers? How do we know whether it's working?
Test it on some participants.
Test it on some participants. Could do. But that's more about the user interface aspects. Maybe that they like it, they can use it, that's true. So if they can't use it, if they don't like it, then they're not likely to use that particular application, so we're not likely to see any benefits. But say if you're looking at the big picture, the co-op's big picture isn't whether they like the app or anything, it's whether they get more people into their stores, whether they have more people getting their special offers, whether these special offers get them into the stores. Yeah.
So what the consumer behaviour is currently and what people have issues with.
Okay, so what the current behaviour is, and then what? Then you've got your app, and then what?
Wait, do we have the app already, or are we trying to figure out what it should be?
Well, if you've got a methodology, we said we created the app now.
Okay.
And now we want to see whether the app, we know that the app's working, people like it, people don't like it, but most people like it, they're going to use it. They say, how do we know that that's reality? So, yeah.
Well, what's our group based on the profits? The company will receive more profits because that's the initial reason for it.
Yes, so it's profits. So they will receive more profits, more than before. Yeah, yeah.
Well, so it would definitely be about profits, but you want to generalize it, right? So you want to specialize the search, right? So if the app is about deals on specific items, then you'd have the results of the sales on deals before the app, and then you'd have the sales on those deals after the app was made. And then you'd also correlate it with how many times the app has been downloaded, right?
Yeah.
And then you'd see if there's been an increase in these items.
Yes.
There's a probability that this app has increased sales.
Right, okay.
Well, yeah. Loyalty of a customer does not necessarily mean that a business is going to receive a profit.
No, it doesn't.
They might be loyal because it's cheaper.
Yes, that's true. So it might not be more profits, but it might be more people through the doors.
Also, aren't you likely to get less profit on offers?
Yes, you are likely to get less profit on offers, but the idea is that the offer gets you into the store and then you buy a load of other shit you don't want.
Right.
I guess one of the track would be, so if the app lists just half of the offers that the shop has got, seeing what the, if more people buy offers that are listed in the app compared to ones that aren't.
Yes.
Something like that.
Yeah, absolutely right. So I can see that the methodologies that you're thinking about are good ones, and we can formalise these. So there's different kinds of ways to formalise these sorts of methodologies. And so the thing that we're talking about here is what's called a pre-test post-test. Okay. And in the old language, it's B because you can't get a different participant. You don't know who the participant groups are. They'd be what's called between subjects. Okay. So the way that you plan out your experimentation is so that you can understand what statistical analysis you can use afterwards. Yeah? Okay. Okay, so data analysis. Well, we've already seen data analysis, so I'm saying mostly statistical analysis. Why is it mostly statistical analysis, do we think? Yeah?
You're unlikely to test on everybody.
You're unlikely to test on everybody, so if we want some kind of generalizability, that's the case. What about what else? Just pragmatically. Okay, well, numbers make us feel more secure about what we're saying. Yeah? So, you want to be able to go to the co-op and say, oh, that lady, you know, 95% of cases, people love this, as opposed to giving them a long message about how people have said they really love it, or they really like the app, or they really are going to use it. That's all fine. That's icing on the cake. But what the co-op say might what we want is some hard numbers. How do you know? Yeah? How do you know this is right? And so, coding in the ethnographic sense. So if we were looking at coding in the ethnographic sense, why was coding actually invented anyway? We did this, yeah.
To try and get something quantitative out of the qualitative.
Yes. To try and get something quantitative out of qualitative work, so that we can quantify it, so we can say, well, actually, 400 people thought this, and only one person thought that, even though we've interviewed 401 people, and we don't have any other metrics, but it was mentioned multiple times by multiple people. Yeah? They want something to be quantifiable. So that's why it was invented, to give this kind of idea of more scientific rigour. Okay. So, we have different kinds of things. So we have, I think we've been through this before, but we're going to go over it again because it's important. Descriptive statistics, inferential statistics. So the first thing, what does descriptive statistic mean? What's a descriptive statistic?
Is that a property like of a data set of something?
No, not quite. Anybody else?
The ones that you've got on the actual sample is very simple.
Yes. Yes. So the descriptive statistics is the data that you've got from the actual sample. So say I pick three people because, you know, I'm really bad at this kind of stuff. And three people are out of this whole population in here, they're not going to be representative. You know, I'm picking these three. So okay. So if I'm picking these three and they're not really representative, all I can say is that I know they're not representative. But I'm going to say that the data they've given seems to be, the information they've given seems to have some descriptive statistics associated with it. So they're all saying the same thing about a certain point. Okay, they all agree that my lectures are crap. So or something. Or they all agree there's too much to read. Or they all agree something. But I know that the sample is too small, so I can only describe the sample results. Okay. And this mostly, not only, but this mostly works around measures of central tendency. So does anybody know anything about central tendency? Okay, so I'm not going to get into this because I just want you to know it. It's not going to be tested. So say we've got, what's that look like to you?
Consumer distribution.
Consumer distribution, that, okay.
Yeah, it looks
like it, Dobson curve, that's right, yeah. It's actually a standard distribution. Let's say it's a standard distribution. Okay. So, this thing here, what's this thing here?
Mean.
Okay. So all that central tendency means is that we're looking at how far something is distant from the mean. Okay? And what we're also looking at is, well, what we're looking at with, say, standard deviation. Okay? It's another description. Standard deviation is another description of distance from the mean based on the total distances of all of the samples in here from the mean. Okay, so you can see how it sits with all the other, how your one point sits with all the 20 other points that are in here. Okay, how it compares. Now, what do we know about if we put lines down this? What do we know about these lines? What do we know about any of this? Has anybody seen this standard distribution stuff before? Yes, one or two. Oh. Nobody else? Okay.
Isn't it the middle two, like, should be two-thirds of the population?
Yes. So the middle two should be two-thirds, and then it loops out to these next. And so you should have the vast majority of the distribution under this part. Okay? Alright, so what we're trying to measure is how far people agree or disagree. So for instance, you three guys, if I'm going to do this, I'm going to say, oh well, I want to look at the central, I want to understand your information. Yeah. You all say that there's too much work, and you all say there's too much work like this. Okay? You all think, yeah, there's too much work. So I think, well actually, you're giving the same answer. You're all giving the same answer. If you look like that, I'd be thinking, ooh, what can I say? Nothing. They don't actually, they're nowhere near this central tendency, and they're nowhere near each other. Yeah? So I can't believe what you're saying. But if you're like this, then I'm far more likely like this. I'm far more likely to understand that your grouping is because you three are certain that it's too much work in this lecture. In this course, and you don't disagree, it's likely that everybody else will think that as well. But I can't make an inferential statistic of it. All I can say is it's describing a possible tendency to everybody else. So that's the first one. Descriptive. What's inferential? What's inferential? We've just had descriptive, so when somebody's spoken to me about that. Inferential, yeah.
When you have a representative sample?
When you've got a representative sample, and when you think that sample is a good indicator of the population, and you can infer something, that the results of this sample can be inferred over the rest of the population without testing the rest of the population. Yeah. Okay, and then we have two other things. Internal validity. What's internal validity?
When the sample is correct.
Right, yeah, when the sample is correct, when we know that the sample has a validity, that everybody says, when everybody says the same thing, when it's all harmonious, okay? What about external validity? Yeah.
When you can generalise that to the whole population.
Yeah, when you can generalise it to the whole population. Okay, so internal validity is linked with descriptive statistics, external validity with inferential statistics. And confounding variables. Confounding variables, come on.
Things you can't account for in the analysis, something external to the whole thing that could sway one way or another.
Things that, well, you can account for them.
Right, you can account for them, you don't know what they are.
You don't necessarily know what they are, that's right. But so what you can do is, in a laboratory-based study, which isn't representative of the real world, possibly, you can make sure that your work and your methodology discounts all these other confounding variables. You can make the time the same that people get to spend on doing a test. You can make their educational background the same. You can make their age the same. Okay, so you can actually, so that then you know it's not to do with age, it might not be to do, or with confounding variables, you might want to actually remove aspects of the real world. So for instance, if you do a survey in the real world, outside, say, not in a laboratory-based situation, you might get lots of people who are in a good mood or in a bad mood. They're rushing to work because you're getting these people at rush hour, or they want to get home because it's, you know, night time, okay, they finish work. So they're going to give you different information, because these confounding variables are that they want to get home from work. Yeah? They don't want to give you the answers to your questions. Yeah? So these are confounding variables. Okay. Say for instance, you do an experiment. I've seen this happen so many times. You do an experiment, you've written your app, and you do your experiment over that app. And then you get some data that says, oh, people would really like it if this additional thing on the app was changed. So they change that thing and then do another experiment, as though you can take these two groups both together. But this thing might be a confounding variable, okay, that you've changed. So in laboratory-based experiments, nothing changes. Everything's consistent. Whereas in the real world, things change all the time, okay, because it evolves. Okay. Okay, so we have some kinds of sampling. A simple random sample. Okay? Don't read that. I should have got this thing up. Does that reveal one thing at a time? So what does it mean? Well, I think we've already seen what simple random sampling is. So what about systematic sampling? I would say systematic sampling, go around like that. Don't read your labels. Systematic sampling, what is that about?
Is that where you can know about the population and you can therefore pick a sample that would represent the demographic?
No, it's not quite like that. It's where you, okay, so systematic sampling is where you follow a particular methodology for picking participants or picking a sample. So for instance, we do this a lot with websites. So if we're looking at we might look at the Alexa top 500 English-speaking websites. So we could randomly pick 10. Those random samples might be all clustered to the top, the bottom, in the middle. Who knows? Okay. But what we can do is pick every 10th one, every 5th one, every 20th one. So we get a stratified view. You know, we can see this through the entire sample. So you've got some systematic way of picking your sample. Okay. That's the first. Then we've got the stratified sampling. So in stratified sampling, stratified sampling, you've got a
Does that not assume some orders?
What?
Like the example you just gave there in rank order, right? So you're taking a selection of every.
So we're saying the population.
How do you find an order to use in order to do that?
Oh right. So in this point, you don't. I mean, the top 500, their order that they use for election is how popular they are. So their popularity is ranked. So you have to justify why you're doing this, of course. So we might say that, so one of the justifications we gave, for instance, is that we were looking at Web 2 widgets and Ajax technology. And we were saying that Ajax technology is most likely used on the most popular sites, okay? Because that's where the investment's going for coders to build this stuff, which they're not in a good way. And this is where the investment's going for the companies who can see benefits in Web2 technology. So tickers and, you know, auto-suggestors and those kind of things, calendar pickers. So what we said, well, so that was our rationale. But we also said that this might vary. So if we go do a random sample, we'll get something all at the bottom. Or we'll get something all at the top. Or a bit in the middle. So what we wanted is this systematic way of picking stuff. Okay? Now, a stratified sample is where you've got a layer, where you decide to pick a layer of information. Okay, so you can't say much about what's above it and below it, but you're picking this layer of information. Okay, so that's another sampling method. It's not just participants; it's resources that you're going to test too. So it's not just people; it's things. you can do it all, like we do it with certain websites. Okay. Multi-stage sampling, what do you think? Multi-stage sampling, what do you think multi-stage sampling might be? So say I want to know whether user experience is an effective thing for, is a good thing for, I don't know, whatever, teaching to undergraduate students. So if I pick you guys and give you a questionnaire and you say, oh, it's really great, okay, then I know something about this population, but I don't know it about the user experience course at York or Lancaster, if they do indeed exist, which of course they don't. York or Lancaster, yeah? I don't know anything about that. So what do I need to say then? I need to do the same for them and the same for both of those, and that's another state, so that's a multi-state sample. So then you can get stronger. So if they say, oh yes, we all think it's great, it means it's not about me. I can't be a confounding variable because it's taught by different people. It's not about the information that's being presented because they'll all be presenting the information differently. It's not about the university, the lecturers. It's not about that you're particularly excellent students. Of course, this is the first top university in the UK for computer science research, right? So you are the top students. So that's the kind of that's the kind of multi-stage sampling we do. Quota sampling. What do you think quota sampling is? Who said something about demographics at the back? Yes. Quota sampling is like demographics. You're looking to get a quota of something. So, for instance, if you're in the street, we've had this conversation before, In the street, people want to know what your political views are. So they come up and they've got a little, it's a moray poll or whatever. So we know that they've got a quota to fill. Why have they got a quota to fill?
Because they want to generate a meaningful sample.
Generate a meaningful sample, and that quota that they're trying to get will be demographically split, so they'll be trying to get 50% of men and 50% of women, say, or whatever the actual demographic is for that. Okay? Different age ranges they'll be trying to get to. Okay? So they'll have to fill specific quotas. Because they only want to sample 1,000 people, not 52 million. Yeah? So how? Why do they have a quota? Why don't we just let them go off on one?
And they'll just pick the people who want to talk to them.
That's one thing, but what did we have this discussion earlier on? What do
they want to talk to?
They'll pick who they want to talk to, and we know that if you're a man, you'll pick 20-year-old girls to talk to, and if you're a woman, you're going to pick 30 to 40-year-old males to talk to, and if you're told to go and question canvas an area, you're going to not go to the houses where there's a dog barking. And you're only going to go to the bottom floor of an apartment block. Because you're not going to do anything more than that. Why would you? You've just got that quota to fill. Just give me randomly 10 people or 50 people. Okay, so that's what quota sampling is about. Trying to make it demographic, okay, of a particular quota, of a particular sample, of a particular population. Yeah? Now, the other one that was on there, it's kind of the inverse of that. It's called snowball sampling. Or it can also be called a convenience sample, but snowball sampling. What do you think snowball is?
Do the person you're asking pick the next person?
Oh no! That actually might be useful. If that was, yeah.
So, like you said, with going into block of flats, where you just do the, because you're in that block of flats, you don't really move. You just go from door to door in block of flats, so you kind of snowball around the building and then build your quota in that block of flats. So.
Absolutely right, yeah. So if you see people on the street and there's no quota, then they'll just be going, get that one. Oh, somebody else is coming here, get that one, get that one, get that one. Okay. So it's a snowball convenience sample. Now there's a difference between these two things in that oftentimes with a snowball sample, now it can be interpreted in two different ways. So often they're interpreted together depending on what community you're in. So a convenience sample would be specifically this one where there's just convenient participants coming up and you're just going grabbing this, grabbing that participant. Snowball can be interpreted like that, but it can also be interpreted that I do you, and then you tell me all of your friends, and then I go and do all your friends. And then they tell me all their friends, and I go and do all their friends. Okay. So then, it's both convenient time, but it's also a snowballing thing. So you're sort of, it's like a snowball, picking up participants based on what's already in the snowball, if you like. Okay, so convenient sampling, and judgmental sampling. Okay, let's not talk about that. Judgmental sampling. Now, one thing I've not said here, it says probabilistic. And then we have quota sampling, snowball sampling, convenient sampling, and judgmental sampling. Okay? What do you think non-probabilistic means? Yeah. So, okay, so here, the process of snowball sampling is much like asking your participants to nominate other people with the same trait that they have. So if you like Facebook and all your, you know, and I'm talking about Facebook, you say, oh, everybody else like, I've got all these friends on Facebook, so here you are. But it's not, I'm saying this here because I want to make the separation between that and convenience, where I'm just saying these are the easiest people to recruit. So for instance, if I wanted to ask questions about my research, which might involve eye tracking or whatever else, I'm far more likely to be able to intimidate some of you guys to do it, and you know, then so that would be convenient. Yeah. But it wouldn't give me a good probabilistic sample because you know we might all be the same. Similar. Yeah. But link convenience with snowball because in different communities they're the same thing, or people take it as being the same thing because they're so similarly constrained together. So when you're actually talking about this, if somebody says, "Oh, we'll do some snowball sampling," just clarify what that means to them, because it might not be what it means to you. Yeah.
Could you say that snowball sampling is, for example, when I question people on the street and say an old lady comes and she's really enthusiastic and they get lots of answers and she doesn't want to question more, then after I've done her, I start targeting old ladies because I was looking for question.
I would say you could think about that because it's kind of an implicit. Because with snowball, normally, it's that it's much like asking your participants to nominate other people based on their traits. Well, actually, implicitly that's what's happening in this case, isn't it? Because they're implicitly saying, they're being talkative and a good participant, say. And so you think, oh, I'll do more of these guys because they're good participants. Yeah. And so it's an implicit, so therefore she's recommended the other people, not explicitly, but implicitly based on her traits. Okay, yeah. So, well, you can also then say, well, it should be convenient sampling. Because convenient, you're saying, they're the easiest to recruit for the study. So, if you see one, then you think she'll be easy because the other one's easy. So, you know, that's why you have to differentiate the two. They're kind of overlapped. And judgmental is that you have an authority that tells you that these are the people to sample. Why might you get an authority that tells you these are the people to talk to or to sample or to be participants?
When they want the results to be
whatever they want them to be, but also it's maybe if you know a certain set of people in your work environment who work in a certain area, then that might be an authoritative authoritative sample. So we did some work yesterday with Thomson Reuters, and we needed some pharmacokinetic people from pharmacy. So that's an authoritative sample because we're saying these are this particular person. These people are these particular people will be useful to you, so can you do the work? Okay, in more general terms, when might you get that? What would you, if you were linking this up to other bits of the course that you've studied? So what about, who knows the term key? Well, go for
it. I was going to say, if it was like something about the client within, like if it was developing for a certain company, like their board of directors or whatever, that's going to be a thing.
Yeah, that's going to be a thing. Yeah. So if they're higher up in the hierarchy, and also in the corporations, then yeah. Who are, what other kind of thing that we've looked at in, say, observational work? Ethnography. So you have this concept of a key informant. Do you understand that? We did go over it. You're all obviously, at that time. Key informant, anyway. So they'd be an authority. So they'd be judgmental about it because they'd say, well, the key informant says you need to speak to these people. Okay, because they know the community better than you. And if you took a random sample, you might not get these people. In fact, you're highly likely to not get them. Yeah? But they'd be useful to what you want to know. Okay. Okay, we'll speak a bit. So there's different kinds of testing that we're going to do. And this testing, or that you can do, this testing is all about understanding the statistics that you can use and the quality of the outcome that you're going to get. So the first one is single group post-test. What do you think that is? It's all in the name. Remember, at all occasions, you have this thing. You have an app, you have something that you developed, or there's something that you've changed, or there's something here.
That's the app.
Yeah, there's a single group of people, you have no baseline, because you have really no idea what they thought about it before, or their experiences before about anything. So then you just say, well, here's the intervention, here's the thing, the app, whatever it is, do a test afterwards. So this can be useful for us, because we can discuss things where if we've got a new application we've built, we can look at task completion time, we can look at how easy it is to find your way around, navigate interactive behaviour, so, because we don't have a baseline to base it on. Okay, single group, pre-test and post-test.
Yeah.
Right, so you've done a pre-test first. Now, what does the pre-test give us?
An indication of what we expect from it, perhaps it was certain app that you're telling them about.
Kind of, but maybe not in this case, yeah.
Give you something to. See how big the change was?
Yes,
change.
It's about the change. So it's about comparison. So the pre-test gives you a baseline of you haven't done anything, you put your app in, and then there's a post-test if you want to look at a wider view. Yeah, and then you can see what the comparison is between the two. Like, if you've introduced a new, if you've introduced a new app that gets more people into co-op stores, you can see how many people were going into a particular store and whether your app drove more people into it or away from it. Yeah?
How can you get qualitative stuff, though, about the thing that you've built from that?
Okay, so if you're comparing the computer system that they had with your new computer system, then you can say, you can look at how many the orders they put through, how fast they get to certain aspects of the navigation that reduces their time. On both. So you do it on the old system first, you do it on the new system, and then you get a comparison.
But isn't that quantitative? Because you measure it.
Do you say qualitative?
Yeah, so because like, if you haven't got an app to.
Oh, no, you can't. All of this here.
That's what I'm checking.
All of this here is quantitative work, so it's all experimental, and it's all, mostly all this is created from psychology and cognitive science, and it's all about, it's mostly about understanding. The differences in a laboratory setting, okay, where you're controlling, you've got a tightly controlled experiment. And there's things that are called true experiments and things that are called non-true experiments. Okay? And so it's all about experimental work. Now, natural control group. What do we think natural control group is? So here we say natural control group is a group of people who are natural users of the system. And that's different to the randomised one, which is just we're randomly picking people, as we were saying before. Yeah. So we've got natural control group, which means they're natural users, they're just picked based on a sampling method, okay, for the control group. So for a control group, they might be the control group might be the people that you're getting to use the old system. So that's the control group.
So they would continue to use the old system
Yeah. And then you've got the other people using the new system. Okay. So the natural control group might be the people who have already been using that system because they're part of the organisation. Yeah. But then you've got a randomised one. Where the randomised version is that they're maybe not natural users of the system, they're just random people that you're here, because that gives you that random idea that it's more generalisable outside this control group. Yeah? Okay. Then you have. have, well, what's called within subjects. And there are many other types of these, okay? But what do you think within subjects are? And it should really be participants, but, you know, be what subjects are. So within subject work is stuff where the tests are all done on the same people. It's within the group. So the pre-test and the post-test are all done on the same group. Yeah? Between subjects means that you might have a different set of people in the pre-test and a different set of people in the post-test. Yeah? Okay. Ooh, there you are. Okay. Ethical process. We're going to skip, yeah, it's okay, we'll get it in time, don't worry. Ethical process. So, why have we got an ethical procedure for any of the work that we're doing? Why have we got an ethical procedure? Yeah.
Because you've got to take care of the welfare of the participants.
You've got to take care of the welfare of the participants and take care of the welfare of the experimenters as well. Okay, why?
Don't fake the results.
Don't fake the results, that's another one, yeah. But why would, science is a key part of this, so science is really important for the ethical procedure. Why did we even create this stuff then? Why don't I call subjects participants? Why don't I call participants subjects anymore? Well, it creates a power dynamic. Because obviously a subject is somebody beneath me, who's an experimenter, yeah? As opposed to a participant who's equal and trying to be. But why does this matter? It all sounds a bit hairy-fairy, it all sounds a bit woolly. It all sounds a bit, you know, hippie right on. Yeah.
Maybe it's the human psychology that, you know, if you're being called subject, you'll not be like independent in their thought, but you'll just follow whatever is being said.
Well, that's true, yeah. Guinea pig effect, yeah, that's very true. But there's other ones. Okay, so it all starts back hundreds of years ago, where white middle class men like me went out to the colonies and decided that we were going to do lots of experiments for the greater good of science, which involved really fucking up a lot of people as we went about it. Okay, so this was both bad for science, but mainly it was bad for the populations that came under our kind of control, if you like. Okay, and then again, it happened in the 1940s, in the Second World War. There was lots of experimentation done in Nazi Germany, where scientific experimentation for the greater good of science, which involved killing lots of people. Okay, so there needed to be after the Second World War, there needed to be some convention, some way, so that this didn't happen again, so that we would treat people with the respect that they deserved, and that they would get to be beneficiaries of the kind of work that of scientific work that they were participating in. You'll see in your appendices, if you care about it, my long ranting diatribe about this kind of stuff, which goes on for a few pages. Yes?
Was there a set thing that came after the war? Sorry, because there's obviously been an article that I read recently about these German athletes and the kind of war testing about that in the 1980s, 1970s.
Yeah, there was a number of, there's a number of conventions, and so the... Mainly, a lot of this work was done via the American Psychological Association. So APA had lots of rules and they have lots of ethical procedures to stop this kind of stuff happening before, but it's encoded in various conventions that have been changed, actually. So you get some after the Second World War, but then you get some that have been changed, well, quite recently as we learn more. Yeah. And you'll find the references for all of those conventions in the notes. Okay, so... that's the first thing about ethics. Anybody else? Well, we're going to go through it. In fact, here's some of them now. So the American Psychological Association was the first one, and we have a number of other ones. The Belmont Report, Council of International Organisations of Medical Sciences did some, And so all of these sort of evolve over a period of time to, as we know more and we're trying to be better, because we realise these things were, you know, really, really bad. And we also know that through the 70s and 80s, lots of experimentation went on that was bad, and that's why there's a number of other changes. So participants, calling people participants as opposed to subjects is a recent, recent thing. You wouldn't normally get participants in research papers up to about 2000. So even then we call them subjects. And all the textbooks still use the term subjects mostly. Yeah.
When speaking specifically of user experience testing and experimenting, that doesn't involve anything medical or anything that's dangerous to the health of the participants. So what would some of the examples be where you actually could do harm in such a thing as just HCI testing?
Okay, so that's kind of right, but also it's right at the top level, but it's not at the lower level. So for instance, we did some work with users of the mobile web, okay? And we said we don't want to do work on understanding text input in a stationary, static environment, so we're going to do it dynamically. So let's go and walk around the building, in which case you're texting like this and falling down set of stairs. It's not funny, it did happen, you know, or you're walking around the, you know, or you're doing, because there's no risk assessment, so, you know, there is now, but, or that you're walking outside and you're what's called in mobile, but when you're doing this in mobile, it's called edge following, so you implicitly follow somebody or you follow an edge, like a pavement, but that pavement's very close outside here to the bus stop, so it takes one false step and you're in the front of the bus. So that might be something where you've got some physical damage. Now you also might get mental damage. We do work with people with lung cancer. So bringing up that kind of information, that kind of discussion with people with lung cancer, with people who've gone blind after they were 20, 30, 40, with people who have got who are deaf. They can suffer quite a lot of trauma, mental trauma, by discussing this or talking about it. Well, you don't know what kind of user experience you're going to do. So the user experience, just like, you know, the UX stuff in the space shuttle, that's actually, you know, that's not the kind of UX you might think, oh yeah, this is just user experience stuff. But there's lots of ways that you can screw people up. You know? And the way that you normally do it is not because you're thinking, I want to screw somebody up, although, it's because you don't take enough notice of what's going on, of the things that might go wrong. And then you get things that are inadvertently go wrong. And, you know, the reason why we have an ethical procedure at the university is because we get sued by people we screw up. So, you know, they sue us. So if you've gone through the ethical procedure, it means that we don't now have to... it means that the university abstract away our absolvence from being personally liable for this stuff, because, you know, bad things happen. So in other parts, if you're doing ethnographic studies, say, which can be part of the user experience, can be part of the UX stuff, certainly Nokia have a whole department of ethnographers and UX people working together on their phones in different contexts. So those guys, you know, we've had people here who go out to the Israeli occupied territories, and, you know, they want to look at certain aspects of technology use in the occupied territories. Well, what happens if their men get stopped by an Israeli checkpoint? So they have to give that information over, which could be a problem for some of the people they're talking to. So does these guys. So if I was going to link this in my original thought to a story in the news quite recently, what would I link it to? Please tell me you do, like, you know, listen to them, things like that. No?
Don't do the Irish in the US.
No?
And Boston. I think, yeah, Boston at MIT, if you were doing a test on that.
Boston at MIT, okay, but something a bit more that's been in the news, well, okay, 2 weeks ago. What about the ethical procedures that the BBC did or didn't follow when going to do work
North
with
Korea.
The North Korean students? Nothing signed? Nothing signed to say, oh yeah, this is what's going to happen. You know, you get to Beijing and then say, oh yeah, you're going to be part of a journalistic show on the BBC. Well, you can hardly can you invade your musical instrument? So, there are issues with all of this stuff. Okay. So some of this, in brief, and we're going to be in brief because I think you can do this, about you. You need to have competence, integrity, and you need to follow the scientific method. Why do we need to follow the scientific method? Because if you don't follow the scientific method, the work you've got is bad science. And if it's bad science, there's no point in doing it. If you're going to put people through various trials and procedures, then there's no point in doing it if it's bad science. If what you're going to get out isn't useful, why did you ask somebody to do this? Okay, about them. So the first one is respect. You need to respect your participants. It's usually a good plan. Benefits. There needs to be some benefit normally to the participant or the group from which they come. Okay? So there needs to be some benefit for them. There needs to be justice. Okay? Who will benefit from the results of the work? And then trust. You need to actually be open and maintain some level of trust. Don't tell them things that aren't going, that you're going to do. Don't keep secret things that you're going to do. Okay? Even in medical trials, you have to say there's going to be a placebo and there's going to be a real drug. Okay? So the people getting the placebo are obviously not going to be. You're not saying that it's all the same drug. Half will get a placebo, half will get a real drug. Okay. So they know that it might be that they, that some of the people in the trial will have benefits, sometimes benefits where they live, and in the other part of the trial, benefits where they don't. Yeah? No benefits, non-benefits. But it benefits science, because then we know that something actually happens. Okay, responsibility, you have a duty of care. Don't let people fall downstairs or under buses, etc. Okay, we're not going to do that, we're not going to do that, we're not going to do that. Oh, good. Right, go for a coffee. Back here in 4:15, and we're going to do it in real life. Okay? And don't go away. Don't leave. You're all very quiet today. I can see you just thinking, oh, I'm going to go and I'm going to come back. This will be interesting and important for examines, yes.
Good. How are you?
Fine.
Finished the report?
No, but I'm finished the play, hopefully.
Yeah, it's almost, I mean, I'm not going to
I don't know, I didn't get it. The reason I'm quiet today.
One managed to like, it's not escape, but they got like one of the animals. Yeah. And it's like a mutant seal.
Yeah.
It's like a.
Yeah.
I know. But obviously they have a front that it's like get good medicine out and all that. Research participant. I don't know who the hell would want to go participate in that.
Just show me a bingo, basically.
Yeah. Once I've won that, you know? That's down the road, It's like £3,000. It's like £3,000, and you can have. We are constantly.
What is it?
No, I'm not going to do it.
Of all of that, so you'd actually do storyboards on their projects. you do scenarios on their projects, you do percentages on their projects, you do the kind of things that they do, you do eye tracking on their projects. Okay, and they use their projects as motivational examples for you to do it practically. And then you do that, and then you just have another X lectures here, and then you finish at Easter, and you wouldn't have another after that because we've already done all 20 for that.
I personally think that'd be amazing.
Yeah? Okay, so who would, hands up who would do that, and hands up who wants it just as it is? I want everyone to put their hands up and I'll just interpret it as well. Who wants it as that, as this new kind of different way of doing things? Ah, good. Yes, I'm taking that as... Because this is just me deciding this is what I want to do, so I'll just get you on board. You know, it's on camera, there's enough hands. It's a majority.
Eight lectures.
I've got my special way of doing it because the timetable on Wednesday is changing next time. So, yeah, if you're a sports person, you'd have to have that time off. One day off your sport, one afternoon.
I guess as long as like it could be accounted for your absence in every day today.
Yeah.
Not that, you know, the intentional message, but...
Well, it means, I mean, materially they're all going to say. It's just that you get the practical way of implementing it, of actually doing it in the context of their projects. So you'd still, so everything's still the same. It, with regard to the material, yeah.
Well,
you put your hand up, so you're as well.
What I was going to say was...
You can't answer.
As we discussed, UX design is quite subjective, so when you're going to a different institution to teach the same subject, you need to make sure that the standards of teaching and what it's taught is the same.
Well, I'm going to be there, so yeah, I will.
You will be asking another institution to provide the service that you wouldn't have done. So you might
get
two other
topics at the same time. Well, yeah, well, no, because we'll be asking the BBC to provide it in collaboration, so it'll be a collaborative deal. So it won't be just them doing it, I'll be there. It's not something to get 8 hours out of teaching. Although that would be outstanding.
Is this what's going to be happening next week? Or whatever that is, when it actually
hits? No, that's next week.
There's
going to be no practical stuff next week, because in 1 hour, a 1 hour lecture.
Right, which is why I'm thinking that's bloody a bit better. I want that and screw next year.
Okay, come back. Okay, so the other one we also want to know is this year we didn't go to the art gallery. Yeah, I noticed people were a bit annoyed, say, because last year they said, oh, it's the first field trip we've been on in all of our, packed sandwiches, packed meat, holding a crocodile going up the street to the city library. It was great. It's like at school. So is that something that you actually, I mean, is it a negative thing that you didn't go this year, or would you actually would have liked to have gone? Okay, that's good. Everybody put their hand up who would both have liked to have gone and not liked to have gone. And I just interpret that as not. No, everyone put your hand up who would like to have gone. Okay, well, that's good. Yeah, okay. Fair enough, good, yeah. Okay, I'm asking you now because you're the hardcore, you're at the bitter end, so if you're here, you're probably more committed than others of them. Everywhere all the 79 has gone.
Is that a good sample then?
I only care about teaching committed people. I don't care about the rest. If they don't want to come, they don't have to come here. Let's see how their exams go.
Why do you go this way?
Curse me, didn't think about it. Well, to the gallery?
Yeah.
Oh, because last year they said we really wanted to go to the gallery, but we also want more industrial stuff to go on, so we want more industrial, we want another industrial lecture, and we'd sacrifice the gallery over an industrial lecture. So we got ThoughtWorks in as the additional one. They were supposed to be in the Mensa this week as another one, but they had to cancel because they had a pitch that they had to do. And we got the BBC coming at the end. So that's those additional, we've only got 22 to 24 hours to do this. So that's why you didn't get it this year, because last year they said given the choice, we'd rather have more industrial lectures than the activities at the gallery. But I think, I mean, I enjoy the activities at the gallery, but you know, because it was correct, it was one. So yeah, that's why I didn't mention it. But you did have more industrial lectures than these guys. Okay. Talking industry, I'm going to spin through these, because you don't, oh, no, you need that. User experience exam. You've all got this, right? You all know where the pain is going to occur. Yeah? And at what time? Yeah? Okay? Yeah, that's right, medical school. Yeah. Okay. Alright, so we're all on the user experience exam. Remember revision questions to me via email. Yeah? So anything you don't know about, anything you want me to go over again, any topics you want me to discuss, then to me, in, you know, sending the information. We will be doing a revision lecture as well with the general failings that occur in your answers through all the courses, because we've got some answers that actually for the third year hypermedia in the web course. Do you, is that still available?
Cancelled this year.
Cancelled.
Well, I think the person wasn't available to do it or something.
Carol, yeah, probably. Okay. Yeah. So. It's that course, so we couldn't give you the answers for this course, so we've got the answers for that course. That's, and it's actually real student answers. We've photocopied the exam scripts. So you can see the kind of marks and why you might not get the marks, or what kind of answers you're supposed to be giving, and what kind of answers in the way that we as lecturers mark them. So even if you haven't got anything specific, it might be useful just for you to turn up and see what kind of things get marks, what kind of things don't, and how you should be writing it. Now, you all might be great, you all might, you know, be getting 80s, 90s percent, I don't know, in your exams, and if you are, fine, you obviously know how to answer them. But if you're not getting that, then, you know, it might be useful to come and see. I have no, you know, I want my standard deviation to hit about, oh, if I could get it 70, I want everybody to get firsts. That's what I start off with, because, you know, I say, oh, my guys are great, and our teaching is excellent. So I want you all to start to get firsts, but that doesn't happen. So I'm not trying to mark you negative. I'm not trying to think I'm trying to hit 55 and everybody will be happy. I want you to get this. I'm trying to mark you as well as I possibly can. So the reason why you don't get the marks is because you don't deserve them, not because of anything else. And you all have the ability, everybody in the third year of this course has the ability to get first. There's not one person among you who doesn't. It's just the fact that you might be, you know, doing other stuff or lazy. I don't know, bored. Yeah?
Is this the second year that this course is run?
Yes.
Right. No, but I was looking for past papers this morning. There's only one. So.
Yeah, there's only one past paper. Yeah. So it's just the this is the second year, and the way that I said that I draw the exam questions, I have a question bank of 100 questions, and I hit randomly, and I have a machine that randomly selects them. So I don't know what I'm.
Is this for the multiple choice?
For everything.
All of them. Right.
Yeah. So each of the parts are randomly selected from a big question bank.
So, I mean, the multiple choice questions are going to be similar to, I mean, the style that was in the past.
Yes.
Are the questions going to be also going to be in a similar style?
Absolutely, absolutely the same style. Right. Yeah. And it's also built up via the Bloom's taxonomy, or well, the amended Bloom's taxonomy, where creativity goes to synthesis, etc. So you've got the book work, you've got the application of technique, discussion with example, and you've got the original thought, which is this kind of creative synthesis. The reason why you most go wrong is when it comes to creative synthesis, when it comes to original thought, you go, oh, I've never seen a question like this before, kill me. And you don't get anything. Nothing. You could write, I'm a fish, and you might get something. Who knows? The reason why people lose 6 marks is because they don't make an attempt to answer it. Okay? So answer something, at least, for God's sake. Yeah? Okay. Right, we're going to blast through in real life, but you should be looking at this. So in real life, well, we can see. What's real life like? So we're on the board. What's real life like? What's your real life like? Well, that's it. How do you find real life? Your everyday life.
Busy.
Busy.
Really busy.
Really busy. So it's really busy, which means it can effects that, you know, things happen that you don't want to happen, and you have to recover from those things, etc., etc. Okay? So, the reality of the situation for user experience, I've been telling you all these ways that you should run the test, pre-test, post-test, blah, blah, blah. Okay? That you should have these kinds of, sort of storyboards, personas, scenarios, all these kinds of things, that you should conform to the principles of accessibility, etc. In real life, it just doesn't work like that. In real life, it's not so structured, it's not so outlined, it's not so sort of perfect. Okay? So, what you need to do is try and do your best with regard to understanding what's required, and then make adjustments as you go on. Okay, so, with regard to the kind of work that people do in real life, it's realistic, it's practical, it's pragmatic, and it's snobby. Okay? So, another word for pragmatic?
Business-like.
Business-like, okay. Anything else?
Reasonable.
Reasonable? I don't know, I always think of pragmatism as,
Well, it means good at business.
Pardon?
It means good at business.
Yeah.
Absolutely. But I think
pragmatism just means, you know.
Be real, don't be a dick, just give me something reasonable.
Or give up all your opinions and beliefs and just do what's most easy or convenient.
Yeah.
So, who knows, but you know, you've got this pragmatism whereby you've got to weigh off and trade and balance one thing against the next. So you might only have three participants, you might not be able to get any more. Okay, so that's one thing that happens in real life. You might not be able to get all the participants in one go. We certainly have it where it took us 2 years to recruit enough participants. Okay, so we were doing tests over all that time, not as a pre-test, not as a post-test, but because we just couldn't get that number of participants. Okay, so these things are difficult to do. All right, so it's sloppy. Okay, so now the sort of more pragmatic part is you, as UX people, there's ways that these things, that your kind of work is often commissioned. And mostly, last week for instance, it was really good that the co-op is really into their kind of UX stuff and that they're putting ThoughtWorks to it properly. But normally that doesn't happen. So we've got these constraints. So the first one is just in time. So what do we think just in time is? Yes? That's right, and in this case, most of the people who are doing the project plan, doing the Gantt chart, or the project managers, have no idea about user experience. In fact, they often don't think about it. So it gets to a point where they've got to add user experience in, and they go, oh my lord, I'm not really an expert in this, so don't think about it. And then, just before their project's finished, they get a user experience person to say, come and do something, or come and tell me this should work in the project, and then it's too late. Okay. It's just in time for the project plan to be created, but it's not enough time for you to do it right with an expert. Okay? Now, the reason why I'm telling you this is because if you're doing user experience, you'll encounter one or all of these at some point in your career. And it's up to you to deal with them. How do you handle that? How do you handle them? But they're going to exist, they're going to happen. Too little time in the project plan. Too little time is allocated to user experience stuff. So there's a time, you'll see a project plan, it could be great with development. Development cycle, user experience. That's the way it works normally. Because they just think, oh, it's a bolt-on, don't worry, not a problem. And there's often no user experience at the beginning, there's no user experience at the start where they're talking about how they're going to specify this. They just want nice specifications. You're software engineers, right? Mostly. So you like a very clear specification, right? Of what you're going to build, do you? I like to know what I'm going to build when I start. The only problem with knowing what I'm building at the start of this is that's why you get feature creep, because nobody's asked anybody, so as things happen, you start to have to add more features. Because that involves real people saying, I don't like this, I didn't like this. Okay, we've got the non-specialist. So then, your user experience has been designed by a non-specialist. So we said, we need to do your experience, get Fred. He's got a cat, he likes fluffy things. Okay? He'll do his experience and be fine. And then he designs it with his amazing cat knowledge. and then you're expected to enact it. You come in as the expected person, because they know he's not got enough. You can plan it, fine. He's got the cat knowledge, but he can't enact it, he can't do it. So we get you guys in, and you just realise it's a bag of spanks, okay? Which you have to recover from in some way. Inadequately funded, it's kind of obvious, okay? They want you to do your experience, but you've got a budget of some, you know, sweet, some milk duds. That's your budget, you know. Come here, do the user experience. There's no budget for participants, no budget for materials, no budget for anything. Okay, but still quite good. All you have to do is ask somebody some questions sometime. You can do that while you're having your dinner, apparently. Of course, all of these have happened to me, so it's not as though, you know, I'm making them up. They do happen all the damn time. Presupposed outcome, what's this?
This is where people think they know what they want already at the start.
Yeah, it's where, well, it's actually where they know what outcome you want, they want from you. So they design it so there's a tiny little bit for user experience because they want the outcome to be what they want it to be. And they know that that's what they've employed you to give it the rubber stamp. Yeah? So Coke, they knew that they wanted new Coke to be the best Coke. So they employ the people who give them the answer they want. It's a presupposed outcome, even though it might be wrong. Yeah? Implicit overrun. So this is where you've got your project plan, and then you've got a nice bit of user experience stuff, and you've got a bit of software engineering stuff. But the reality is that we know that the software engineering stuff is never going to make it, and so it'll overrun into your user experience stuff. But that's okay, because we're really useless. Yeah? So the software engineering takes priority, so there's an implicit idea in the project that software engineering will overrun into UX. Okay, so that's your due diligence. What do you think that is? So due diligence just means that user experience is in the project plan because that's best practice, that's what it says. Accessibility is in the project plan because you have to have accessibility in the project plan. You have to do it just as being the plan. Okay, so they're not really bothered about user experience, they're not really bothered about any of this stuff. What they're bothered about is showing that they've done due diligence across the project plan. Okay? Across the development. So it's meant it, so all it also feeds into this presupposed outcome idea. And then finally, unconstrained experiment, what's that?
Do we want?
Okay, so that's the thing we all like, if you do user experience stuff, because it means that with this unconstrained experiment, it means that they really like it, they really want to understand how to create this app and what, and then test it afterwards, and they just want to pay you guys to do it. Okay, and that does happen too, especially in research. Okay, so you can pretty much do what you like in that context. Okay, well done, constrained. Who knows anything about Google and the way work does work happens at Google? Yeah, so they've got 20% to work on their own projects, or they used to. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, it's 20% to work on their own projects, but anything you make is the product of Google.
Oh yeah, that's
so,
right.
They're paying
you
what's
money.
The point, right?
You well, because you get to just toss around, don't you, for
yeah,
for days.
You wouldn't want to make anything amazing, would you? Because then property, then Google have the IP. I wouldn't. I mean, don't get me wrong, I'd do something that may change the world for better. I'd like to do something like that. But anything that's going to make money, I'd keep that to myself.
That's fine. But the people at Google, you know, they're doing this stuff. I mean, most of the stuff that they've created at Google comes out to this 20%. A lot of them. Even the stuff, this Google Glass stuff, came out of the 20%. Maps. Yeah. What's that social networking thing that my pet shop have got?
Wave.
Yeah, Wave.
Gmail is also another one, to be honest, and that's one of the biggest
things. That's right, yeah. The good thing about some of those, though, is that if you're in Google, you do get promoted. If one of those projects really go, you become the head of the team, so you get the audience involved in the media. Okay. So, information requirements. What do these mean to you in this sequence, in this order? could be ones, could be numeric, 1, 2, 3, 4. What do we think? That's a hierarchy level, that's a kind of a continuum of, shall we say, a spectrum of.
How much time do you have? So if you've got like a lot of time to do UX, then you're going to do stuff towards the poly, because there seems to be a bit more money. Would take a lot more kind of planning and money.
Yeah, so this kind of the kind of information requirements that you might be able to get out there, but they're based on what kind of time frame you've got to do this, what kind of money you've got to do this. So in some cases, you know, even given a few days, you can get some kind of flavour of what the sort of what the users are thinking. But in no way will it be formal. Okay, you just get a kind of idea of stuff because it's easy to ask people questions, observe them doing stuff, that kind of thing. It's quite, you can do that quite quickly if you need to. Focus groups, that kind of stuff. Yeah, that's what they think about it. But it's not really, there's no quantity involved. Yeah? And then you get this ideas thing. So here, you get the flavour stuff, but also people come back with ideas that they think are quite good. Now whether those ideas are ever implemented is a whole other thing. Okay? But they come back with ideas that's being missed or that they want to do. Yeah? Informal elicitation. Well, we've done informal elicitation previously, right? And formal, based on our storyboards, our urinal diagrams, our data flow diagrams, that kind of thing. Yeah? Okay? Presupposed outcome. What's that? They give you money, but it's a bribe. Because they want the outcome they want. That's the way that they show that they've done their work properly, that the outcome they want is the outcome they get. Yeah? And then you've also got this laboratory incitation, which costs a lot more. And it's a lot more money, and there's a lot of additional hoops to jump through, like ethical procedures, ethical approvals, like getting participants, like recruiting them, like controlling for confounding variables, methodology creation, all that kind of stuff. So it takes a lot more time to do that kind of thing, really, okay? To plan it. Okay. So these are the limitations you might have. Time. So we've always got a limitation of time. Anything we do is always a limitation of time. Participants. Why participants can be a limitation?
Because you need to be pragmatic. You know, you've got, if you've only got a certain amount of budget or time, you don't want to get, you know, that overflow with getting too many people in.
Okay, that's one way, yeah, that's one thing.
There's no guarantee people will participate.
It's far more likely. You just can't get people. They just don't want to do it. So we, you know, you always have problems with trying to get people from your population to come as a sample. So in this kind of work, it's really difficult to draw a good sample because you just can't get the kind of, you just can't get enough people. Okay. And so those people come over lots of space, you know, lots of time. Well, so it might take you 2 years to recruit, 3 years to recruit participants, yeah.
So what's the purpose of UAT then, user acceptance testing, in big corporations? They do release the product to UAT, you know,
yes. So the user acceptance testing in big corporations, well, one, they've got a population which they can control because they can give them time off. They can say, right, of your working day, you're going to go for half a day to this thing and do those tests. It's part of the work that they can factor in. So that's kind of, well, what kind of sampling would that be?
I don't think it would be a sampling, it would be the whole population.
It could be the whole population, but if you were taking a sample, it would be authoritative, you know, this authoritative sampling we're talking about. So that kind of thing is useful, but it doesn't happen very much. So when you've got a big development, a big corporation, maybe like at the like the guys at the co-op, they were talking about this. But how many participants did the co-op, did the ThoughtWorks do last week? Two. They've done two people. You know, it's not a lot. Even when you've got a population you can in some way control. Whereas, that's not the case for most of the work we do. We're just begging and borrowing, you know, we just... I mean, yesterday we had people, we offered £50 a person and we got three. You know, other days we offer a Mars bar and we get 200. It's crazy. But, you can't guarantee participants. Resources. So resources are useful, so you need things like user testing facilities. Okay? You need software to do this kind of stuff. You need, if you really want to go for it, you need dynamic screen response, you need eye trackers. All this stuff. Okay? So it's all resources are all necessary, including people who know what they're doing. And then finally, you've got skills. So you might have a skills shortage. So the thing that you need to do is design your experiments in the real world to the skills that you have, not the skills that would be perfectly fitting the experiment. Okay, so the skills for the people you have. Yeah, so, and also the kind of resource. If you don't have an eye tracker or GapX ski response or some kind of, or a field recorder, nothing you can do about it. You know, you just have to make the best of it. So think aloud and take notes in your book, in your notebook, and that's the kind of bare minimum. Based on those resources. What kind of instrumentation do we have? We've had that. Data collection, data analysis. I think we've done that. Okay. Optimism. You guys are all optimistic. I can tell by the faces, your faces now. You're about ready to jump out six and go, yay. All optimistic. But optimism is your great. Well, you've got to be optimistic because you think you can solve problems by creating software, right? The world will be better, or at least you'll make some money. By the many million, I mean, how many apps are in the App Store? And how many apps get nothing? Nobody downloads them at all. Lots. But if you're thinking, oh, I'll tell you what, I'll make an app. That's got to be optimistic, right? Because there's like 10 million apps. Okay, so there's optimism there. In everything you do, creation, there's some optimism. And that's both good, but also a downfall. Okay, because you are optimistic. Oh, you know, it's like Scotty on the Starship Enterprise, where he always say, you know, say, oh, we need this, Jim. Jim says, I need this fixing in 10 minutes. Oh no, I can't change the laws of physics. It's going to take 2 hours. That's an engineering perspective, right? You've got to make sure that you're not optimistic. If you can do it in 8 minutes, fine, but still quote 2 hours, because that way you're not going to get screwed at the time, you know, when you don't give it in 10 minutes. Yeah. So optimism is the big failing. Optimism can be your downfall. So I've got a master's student who's doing his master's part time because he's working for a large software company that does booking for British Airways, and they've had a code that's been out there for 8 years, and they've just got their new code, but the code that was out there for 8 years has still got about 80 outstanding bugs in it. Because you just can't get them all. They're just still 80. Even when you bash a few, some more come. Okay? So even though you want to bash every bug, you want to get everything sorted, that's optimism. You can't do it always. So they have to release a product that has bugs in it sometimes. Okay. Brooks. Who's heard of Brooks? The Mythical Man Month. Who's heard of the Mythical Man Month? Bloody hell.
Yeah, Fred
Brooks. Your computer, Fred. Yeah. Your computer scientist, you don't know Fred Brooks?
It's in like every software evolution course so far, every software.
Lawks, a lordy. Okay. Yeah, Fred Brooks. IBM guy. Wrote lots of the kind of large, well, managed lots of large IBM projects for the first IBM mainframes and computers. Okay, and he's got a book, The Mythical Man Month. And so he has a number of things which I've distilled down here. As you can see, I can distill a book into, five takeovers. Yeah? Well, you should read The Mythical Man Month, it's an excellent book. Okay? So, what does Brooks say about adding people? Yeah.
I don't want to quote like. Yes, that doesn't. There's a law of diminishing returns.
There's a law of diminishing returns. You add people, but it actually slows down the project. The project goes slower when you add people to it, not faster. So the more people you add, the slower it goes, because those people take training, they take resources, they're not familiar with the system, and it takes a long time to get them up to spec. And by that time, you decide, oh, we're going too slow, so you add some more. It also takes all the effort for the other people to actually train them, who are already there. So that's why you go slower if you have more people. It's never a good plan. Throwing people at it doesn't work. What about the second system effect? Anybody know anything about the second system effect? So in software engineering, you have this idea where you create a system, and then you have these ideas that happen. If you're UXers, if you've done some of this UX stuff, requirements gathering where people give you suggestions, you think, that's a good idea. But I can't do it for version 1, so I'll keep it on my list and we'll do it for version 2. And you do that so that everything goes to the second system. And then the second system becomes a real hodgepodge nightmare of crap. Everybody's pointless good idea, okay? And that's where you've really got to step back, okay? And think to yourself, do I really want to put this in the interface? Do I really want to put this in the system? Because it's highly likely that you don't. Just because it's there, just because you've been told about it, you just don't, you might not definitely want to do it. Okay, so the second system effect says that beware when you're creating the second one of these, the second system, because you've put all of the dross that you couldn't do, you didn't have time to do, or people suggested, into the second one. Okay, but there's a reason why you didn't put it in the first one. So that way you get feature bloat. You see, you get a nice, clean interface for your first version, but then you want to add all this other great functionality that nobody wants, apart from one person. And then you've got a system that becomes unwieldy, like Microsoft. Okay? Alright. Prediction and accuracy, that comes with optimism. So you predict the time frame it's going to take, and it's all crap. It never is as quick as you expect it to be. Throwaway project. What's that? The more you answer, the less time I take, and then you can go. Good job!
Isn't it something to do that it actually comes in the developer's interest not to throw away a project despite the fact it might no longer be useful?
Yeah, there's kind of that. That's not what it means, but that's very true. There is that as well, yeah. The throwaway project for Brooks means that the first one you develop, throw it away. Okay?
But
that's in Agile. Yeah, so now he's changed his mind because he's got this like changes happen stuff as well. So you expect that change happen, but this was written, you know, 20 years ago, 30 years ago, before we even got to this Agile idea. But so he's saying now in the Agile world, maybe this doesn't matter, this story project, because you're constantly changing it. But sometimes you do need to do that. Sometimes you have this desire to keep what you've got, you don't want to throw it away. So you just keep trying to make it better, make it right, even though it's not. And so at some point you just need to get rid of it. Okay. So in research we do this for our research prototypes. There's a thing where we say that our computer science prototypes are like bunnies in a cage in biology. Okay. You test your drugs on them and then they're going to die. That's it. You're going to kill them. They're not going to become mutant rabbit that's going to run off and save the world. Never going to happen. So, you do your first prototype, you learn a lot from it, you realise all the mistakes, all the inaccuracies. You don't try and correct those, because you'll just screw it up, you just kill it, and start afresh. Yeah,
that's what I was going to say. Basically, yeah, the first time, it's, you know, typical when you're creating software, it's the first time you come across a problem, which is why it's crap. Right?
Yeah.
But then after you've done it, then you're like, well, if I was to do it again, I'd approach it differently. We all did 30 projects, almost all of us have experience of that.
And that's good, that's a good experience to have. So this kind of throwaway aspect where, you know, yeah, you do throw it away when it's a learning outcome. I think that's why this is still relevant even in the Agile development stage, because the Agile development suggests that it's engineering, it suggests that you know what you're doing. Whereas a lot of the things that we're doing as software engineers when we're starting, you don't really know what the problems are yet. You don't, you know, you're looking for solutions. Okay. Wow, we're done. These understand successful questions. Read your notes up to the end. You can see me. I'll see you in 2 weeks. Next week you'll see Andy. You've got some very important stuff to tell you, which will be examinable. The week after next, remember, I want all of your stuff to do with the vision. And if you've got any sense, I'll come to the BBC stuff, because there'll be lots of opportunities for original thought.
That's it.
You are.
Remember this as well.
Oh yeah.